request the chairperson to kindly introduce the speaker and the topic.
So now the first talk is from Dr. Kiran Guleria. Everybody knows her. She is Professor of Obstetrics and Gynecology, UCMS University, College of Medical Sciences, Delhi. Her areas of interest are general obstetrics, high-risk obstetrics, general gynecology, urogynecology, and gynecological cancer. So without wasting time, I ask her to speak about the topic. Okay, we'll wait. No problem.
Thank you very much. I think I'm standing between you and the lunch. So I'll try to finish on time. First of all, I wish to thank our charming Dr. Arshima and her organizing team for giving me this opportunity. Actually, she has allowed me to speak on this topic, which I think is very relevant in today's day and date, perioperative antibiotics, especially in the if you look at the global antibiotic resistance, and especially when there are no more antibiotics in sight, we are not going to have any more antibiotics, so we'll have to do with this. So unless we make our policies for perioperative antibiotics, we might not be left with anything to treat for the various infections. Now the burden of the problem is quite huge. In the latest document by WHO 2016, this surgical site infection is a most frequent type of health associated infection in the low and middle income countries. In high income, incidence is about 2%, whereas in low income countries it is as high as, like, it's almost like 5 to 6 times higher, up to 12%. And you can imagine that one episode of SSI in USA can double the cost of the care and triple the risk of admission. So what will happen in our country? I think it's time we wake up. So this is again the latest data about surgical site infection, where you can see that in Southeast Asia and also in South Asia, where India comes, we are at about 6 to 9% as far as SSI is concerned. So I think higher today, I thought I will answer few questions related to this, which may come to your mind also. But before that, just let me narrate a very brief incident. When I was doing my first year of MBBS, I went to a military hospital called Walker Hospital in Shimla, where my cousin was interning. So I saw the patients were just roaming around with their wounds, which were like stitched, the post-surgical patients, just open wounds with just painted with gentian violet. And then he said, our hospital does not have any antibiotic. We are antibiotic-less hospital. So I was so surprised. So is it possible that you do surgery and not use antibiotics? Of course, we have gone now 50 years ahead. So the first question is this: if you follow all the principles of surgical site infection prevention, which I am sure all of you know that you have a preoperative preparation of the patient, you have a intraoperative, like surgical skin preparation, you have good and meticulous surgical principles, surgeons who are operating, then you have maintenance of temperature, oxygenation, euglycemia during surgeries, so do you still need perioperative antibiotics? So answer in today's day, 50 years later, is actually a big yes. The reason for that is, by giving perioperative antibiotics, you reduce the colonization by the organisms introduced at the time of surgery to a level which your body's own immunity can handle. Our job is not to just kill them and continue giving them. Our job is to just reduce the colonization. So that will decrease the post-operative morbidity and eventually will reduce the healthcare expenses. But each hospital or institution should have its own policy. And depending on your status of the flora and the risk factors, you can make alterations in the, you know, type of antibiotics you want to give, the amount, dose you want to give, frequency and duration. But then there are a lot of guidelines which have come, which tell us how to deal with this, how to go about making policies. So of course, this is again a Cochrane review latest, which says that if you give antimicrobial prophylaxis to prevent surgical site infection, you reduce the risk of infection by more than 50%. So yes, you have to give it. That answer is clear. Now, if you have to give it, then you have to know which antibiotics to give. And if you want to know which antibiotics to give, you have to know what is the common microbes or pathogens which are responsible for infection in your various obs-gyne practice, like cesareans and hysterectomies. And in the light of what kind of surgical wounds we inflict when we do surgeries in obs and gyne, and what are the expected infectious morbidities in our type of surgeries. So answer to this is that sepsis in obs and gyne is due to endogenous polymicrobial infection. Now, infection comes either from the skin or from the vagina when we are doing our surgeries. The likely pathogens are staph, streptoenterococci, and of course, E. coli and anaerobes. All the wounds that we create are clean contaminated wounds, so we need antibiotics. And the morbidities which we are looking at to prevent, apart from surgical site infection, are fever, endometritis, and UTI. So they should also be covered in when we are looking at the perioperative antibiotic. So, but you will be, you know, amazed to see that worldwide, 50% or more of the hospital antimicrobial use is inappropriate. I'm talking about rest of the world also. And if you talk about our country, 90% of us are using antibiotics inappropriately. So what we are heading for if we do not, you know, change our practices now is probably looking at 10 million deaths by 2050 and a lot of cost, which I think I need not tell you. So rational use of antibiotics to avoid antibiotic resistance, to avoid adverse drug effects, and to reduce the cost is very, very important. So then, what are the criteria for choosing a rational antibiotic? So what we are looking at is an antibiotic or antibiotics which should be active against the expected pathogens that prevent SSI and associated morbidity that we talked about, fever, endometritis, and UTI. Should be given at an appropriate time, in appropriate dose, and for appropriate duration, which should be the shortest effective duration to reduce the cost of healthcare. Of course, it has to be safe without any adverse effects, and most importantly, that it should not cause any adverse consequences for the microbial flora of your patients or of your hospital. This is very important. So for this, I think what I give simile is that the perioperative antibiotic should be like an Indian army, which go ahead and do the surgical strike, go strike at the right time, do the maximum casualty, stay there for the briefest possible time, and then they come back. And the terrorist is, you know, so that bacteria, we attack them in such a way. Now, I don't know about the, I think I'll just take 1 minute, if you minus this from my presentation. I just want to know, from one or two of you, what are your antibiotic policy for cesarean section? If you're doing an elective cesarean section, what is your policy? Any, I think I would like to know from any one of you. So which antibiotic are you giving and? So you're giving third generation cephalosporin. And is it single dose or multiple doses? Do you continue later? Okay. Yeah, okay. So you kind of following the guidelines. You don't need the post-operative antibiotics. But anybody from the private sector, especially in like DMC, what is your, where Ashima has gone somewhere, what is your practice? What antibiotics are you giving and how are you kind of? So you're doing second generation. And a single dose? You give 3 doses. So there are, you know, various practices which are there. Though in our hospital also we had been using the third generation only, because that is what was available to us. But now we are trying to change the policies. Now the guidelines say, as far as the, now the, we have to answer on the choice of antibiotics, timing, dose and redosing, and duration of prophylaxis. Now as far as the choice and time of the antibiotics is concerned, we should give an antibiotic, you choose something which is effective against gram-positive, gram-negative, and some anaerobic coverage should be there. So for that, beta-lactam and cephalosporins have a comparable efficacy as far as caesarean section is concerned. The drug should be given intravenous because you want to have a reliable, predictable serum and tissue concentration. Now there are a lot of studies, as most of the people here are giving half an hour before, which is just the right time. People have, you know, given it from 60 to 120 minutes before to as near like 3 minutes before giving an incision. So there are various studies, but I think the policy which is best is that you should give a single dose of first generation cephalosporin, that is IV cefazolin, and 2 gram within 60 minutes. Now some of the guidelines say before anesthesia, but our Indian guidelines say before incision, which should be, which is a better practice to do. If she is allergic to cefazolin, then you switch on to IV clindamycin, which is combined with gentamicin single dose. Or if you don't have this option also, then you can go for vancomycin. Now ICMR also says the same thing, that you give the first generation IV cefazolin 2 gram within 60 minutes. Minimum interval between incision should be 15 minutes and preferably 30 minutes. If allergic, then you give to clindamycin or gentamicin. They have given as 80 milligram stat, but rest of the guidelines say 5 milligram per kg single dose. So now you have the option of giving cefazolin, you have option of giving cefuroxime, you have even the option of giving co-amoxiclav, that is Augmentin, 1.2 gram stat, IV dose can also be given. Now now the second thing to look at is, look at the weight of the patient. Patient, if she is obese, that this much dose may not be sufficient for her. Our idea is that her skin, subcutaneous tissue and adipose tissues all should be loaded with antibiotics at the time when you give the incision. So if her weight is, the American Association says if her weight is more than 120 kg, then you increase the dose of cefazolin to 3 gram as compared to 2 gram. Otherwise, in the Indian context, I think the ICMR says if your patient is more than 100 kg, you should increase the dose to 3 gram. Now, this is the ACOG, which has recently come out with lot of options for caesarean section deliveries. Though the preferred drug is cefazolin, the other regimens, which if you have in your, like in your setup also, if you have, you can also give MP-Sulbactam combination, 3 gram. An alternative regime is to give Clinda or Venco and combine it with either Genta or this is the newer antibiotic, Atrazine 2 gram IV. There is another alternative regime which you can practice, that is Metronidazole single dose plus Gentamicin single dose. So now you have lot of options you can choose from when you are planning your policies. Now redosing, as has already been said, a second dose is usually not needed for the kind of surgeries which we do, but if there is a significant delay, that is more than 60 minutes have already been lost, already elapsed. Suppose your patients are waiting, you know, in a queue, especially in government hospitals like us, where you have given the dose of antibiotic and patient is waiting. And now she's already 1 or 2 hours since the time she's received the antibiotic and the incision is going to start. So that is the patient that where the redosing should be done. Second is if the operation lasts beyond 3 hours or if the blood loss is more than 1500 ml during the operation, then you have to give the second dose of the prophylaxis. Now for the second dose, it also depends on what is the drug you are giving, whether it is cefazolin, clinda, venco. So you will change your, it will actually depends if the duration of surgery lasts for more than 2 half-lives of the drug. So depending upon that, so for cefazolin, it has to be repeated if the surgery has gone over 3 hours. Now when you are redosing, you should also look at the factors like suppose she has renal insufficiency. So here you have to redose her after a longer period of time because she does not have a good power to excrete. So she has the even the first dose staying in her system for a longer period of time. So you, when you are redosing, you have to look at these factors also. So now, vancomycin is a drug which should it be used for prophylaxis? It's such a drug which is used kind of last resort. So should it be used for antimicrobial prophylaxis? So answer to this is, in routine prophylaxis, it has no role. But if you know that there have been clusters of SSIs due to MRSA detected at your institution, so then that is the time you should add vanco. Or if the patient is already known to be colonized with MRSA, or if the patient is at high risk of MRSA colonization even in the absence of surveillance data. For example, the patient has undergone lot of hospitalization in various hospitals the patient has been, or if she has been on hemodialysis, immunosuppressives, so that is a patient who would require vancomycin. And also patients who have beta lactam allergy and not responded to the second line drug, that is Clinda. So they are the patients where you would use vancomycin. Now what about post-operative? Normally I see that in the post-operative period also the patients continue to have IV antibiotics for 24 hours to 48 hours, and then they are switched over to oral antibiotics till the stitch removal is done. But for the surgical site infection, the single dose therapy is as efficacious as multi-dose therapy for cesarean delivery, because it reduces cost, it reduces toxicity, it reduces the risk of colonization with the resistant organism. In fact, most of the guidelines have recommended against the prolonged surgical prophylaxis. It may be rather deleterious for the patients if you give multiple and prolonged doses, because it increases the risk of acute kidney injury and Clostridium difficile infection, which later on becomes difficult to handle. So these are the recommendations. If you look at the various guidelines, every guideline says single dose or maximum up to 24 hours. After that, you must stop all prophylaxis. Now suppose if you put a drain or you put in a catheter which is going to be there, will you extend your prophylaxis? The answer is no. Even single dose prophylaxis should not be extended just because we have put in a drain or we want to leave the catheter for a longer period of time. And there is no need to continue the antibiotic prophylaxis just because she has a drain or a catheter. Now, are your policies going to be different for emergency cesarean section versus elective? So answer to this is also no, because antimicrobial prophylaxis remains the same whether it is emergency or elective section. However, if you are dealing with some dirty or contaminated procedure, so suppose patient has pyoperitoneum, chorioamnitis, or has perforated colon, and if she is already on the antibiotics which you think will also cover the surgical site, then you need not give the antimicrobial prophylaxis. Only thing which you can do is you can just reschedule the dose 1 hour, within 1 hour of the starting the cesarean section. However, if you think that the antibiotic she is on is not going to cover the surgical site infection, in that case you can go ahead and give the single dose of antimicrobial prophylaxis within 1 hour of starting the incision. Now, what is extended spectrum? Nowadays, reports have started coming that for emergency cesarean sections, if you add metronidazole, azithromycin or doxycycline to first or second generation cephalosporins, you might reduce, you may have a better outcome as far as the surgical site infection is concerned. But as far as I know, there was a recent study done in PGI where addition of metrogel did not give any additional benefit. However, there is another study which has come in 2019 where addition of azithromycin 500 milligram IV stat to the usual antimicrobial prophylaxis has been shown to reduce the risk of post-cesarean wound infection. So I think that is something which can be explored. So I think now I'll quickly shift over to hysterectomy, which is not very different from what we have the prophylaxis for cesarean section. Now, recommendations for the gynae surgeries: all women undergoing laparoscopic vaginal abdominal or surgery for urogyne, including mesh, should receive prophylactic antibiotics, that is clear. For the prophylactic antibiotic also for the hysterectomy remains the same. It is cefazolin or second generation cefuroxime. And if the patient is allergic, then you can add, then you can go on to Clinda plus Genta. But only difference here is, if you think your vagina is going to be open for a longer period of time, or if you are doing surgery through the vaginal route, or if you are going to do a radical surgery where you will remove a part of upper vagina, so those are the patients where you should add Metrogyl single dose, that is to cover the anaerobes. Otherwise, the prophylaxis policies are the same. And for the similar policy has also been given by ACOG, where they have given the same alternatives which they have given for the cesarean section. That is, you have the option of empiselvectin, you have option of metronidazole plus gentamicin or fluoroquinone. What is happening? So, as far as the other procedures are concerned, I think you know all those who are doing laparoscopy surgeries need not give more than single dose of antimicrobial prophylaxis. Is my slide going off? Okay, just one or two more slides. So for laparoscopy, if you are doing any laparoscopic procedure, if you find that there is evidence of PID or dilated tube, then only you will extend the antibiotic as oral doxycycline 100 milligram BD for 5 days. Now this is true for HSG also. Otherwise, single dose oral doxycycline prophylaxis. But if you think there is evidence of PID, okay, I think my slides are not moving. They have cut me off. So I will just like to say that was actually my. Can I have my for the slide? It's not moving. I'll just be finishing now. So that's all. Thank you. So I think I'll just like to say this thing, that long courses of antibiotic prophylaxis are often associated with increased antimicrobial resistance, that is one. Then superinfection with resistant pathogens, toxicity and unnecessary cost. So please stop overuse or misuse of antibiotics, and please look into your practices. Have a hospital policy. We also get this antimicrobial susceptibility for making our hospital policies and change them from time to time. So only two take-home messages: that prescribe surgical antimicrobial prophylaxis for appropriate indication judicially, and please, please, please avoid long-term use of post-procedural antibiotics. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Kiran. I think we can also add one message of misuse of fluoroquinolones in view of emerging tuberculosis. They are issuing warnings that we should not be using the ciprofloxacin and levofloxacin for small little things here, there, because they are masking the tubercular part. So I think one word for that also should be there, that withhold, other are better. So fluoroquinolones should be reduced.
So if you looked at the slides, there are 2-3, what ACOG has said.
You put
said
it at the last.
Huh?
Last.
Yeah.
By the time one comes to that, one forgets there is fluoroquinolone.
Yeah. So the
but for levofloxacin, it's coming.
That is the last option they have given. Yes. If you have to give. Yeah, that's true. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Kiran, for such a concise presentation on antibiotics. Since antibiotics would depend upon the type of surgery, like clean, contaminated, and dirty, so there was a question which comes into my mind: would you add Metrogyl if there is a clean contaminated surgery, especially when there is a meconium staining of like during cesarean section when you're posting an emergency cesarean? Would you like to add anaerobe?
So actually, this is what, you know, I have already talked about, that mostly the single dose cefazolin or cephalosporin will give you a little bit of coverage on that account also. And in fact, there are a lot of studies which have come where they say that addition of Metrogyl does not offer any additional benefit. Only thing which has probably come and which might help in preventing surgical site infection when you're talking about emergency cesarean sections is a role of azithromycin, 500 milligram IV if you have, stat along with the cefazolin. So I would say that addition of Metrogyl in a scenario where, which you have asked, is, has probably no additional benefit. So
the literature does not say that.
Literature does not support that.
Thank you so much.
It is only in cases of hysterectomy where you can be, where you know the situation where you have to add the anaerobic coverage in the form of single dose Metrogyl. That is in the scenario of hysterectomies. I think there was somebody. That's great, ma'am. Yeah.
They used to come from outside injection. Crystalline penicillin was the only thing which we used to give. But without antibiotic also, we never had any problem. No wound infection. Uterine scars were beautiful. We could give them vaginal delivery after that also. So now, because of, I think, legal problem, I have also started antibiotic. I don't stop it. I use it for practice. Because in case, she has infection, what answer I'm going to give tomorrow, she troubles me.
That's right, ma'am. I think you're very right. In most of the, I think, missionary-run hospitals, people hardly use antibiotics. And another, I think, the principles of surgery, surgical practices, which were practiced so religiously in missionary hospitals, is probably not being practiced in general hospitals these days. So I actually understand why CMCs were not using any antibiotics. But the thing is, in today's day and date, there are policies which I have talked about today. So you are not wrong in using the antibiotic. In fact, you should use single dose prophylaxis because it has shown to decrease the surgical site infection by about 50%. So you are very right and legally also right. But prolonging and then irrational use, that is what we are not interested in. I'm sure you're right, ma'am. There are certain logistic problems which are beyond our control. We work in a government hospital. Yes. But the solution is not that, since we cannot practice these prevention principles, so we should use more and more antibiotics. No, that solution is not that. Yeah, that is what is recommended. Single dose. So what we are doing is probably not what I am telling here today, but we are trying to come to that part. We are trying to improve our practices so that we are coming to less and less antibiotics. If not single, then at least stop at 24 hours. At least we can aim for doing that. So we can gradually come down to single dose.
And Dr. Kiran, we must talk about the sepsis care bundle, which has been incorporated in the files, especially when accreditation for NABH has come.
Yeah.
There are lot many checkpoints for everybody, including the theatre staff, assistant,
sure.
Staff nurse, washing sister, and everything, even for catheter, cannula, and all that.
Mm.
Probably that will bring down the things.
Absolutely.
Much better,
so that is
in
why
GMCs
I said
also. So look at that file for the sepsis care bundle, which is to be filled up and then endorsed.
Yes.
Thank you.
That's a very important point. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Now I would like to request Dr. Amita to come on the stage. The events of the conference shall continue. Meanwhile, I would like to request you all to take a quick lunch and come back and join the session, please.
I would rather say that the participants should keep sitting for the lecture because it's going to be a very informative lecture on adolescent PCOS. And I would like to invite Dr. Amita Suneja. She is professor in HOD, OB-GYN, University College of Medical Sciences, GTB Hospital, Delhi. Her area of interest is colposcopy, gynecological oncology, adolescent health, and urogynecology. She has major achievements. She has been chair.